Susan Jacoby is author of 11 books, including her newest book called Strange Gods, A Secular History of Conversion, that came out in March. And it's a very unique book as a secular history of conversion. And Susan will gladly autograph books after the afternoon program, and Dan will be there too, and Jerry Coyne. And she also has the books, a classic called Freethinkers, A History of American Secularism, and we have that on hand. It was hailed in the New York Times as an ardent and insightful work. Her other books include The Age of American Unreason, which was a New York Times bestseller. She's also written a book called Half Jew, A Daughter's Search for Her Family's Buried Past. And this book explores the emotional legacy when one parent's origins are treated as a shameful secret. Susan has also written a graceful bio on the great agnostic, Robert Ingersoll, and American freethought. She's an honorary director of the Freedom From Religion Foundation and previously received our Freethought Heroine Award. And she started her writing career as a reporter for the Washington Post. She now lives in New York City and remains today really one of the few journalists who consistently writes about secular issues as an open champion of free thought. This is still a rare commodity in the media, and we can count on Susan Jacoby to speak up in her media columns on state church and free thought issues. Her articles have appeared frequently in the op-ed pages of the New York Times, including February's wonderful column, Sick and Tired of God Bless America, and that's the topic of her talk today. Welcome back, Susan Jacoby.
Thank you very much to the Freedom From Religion Foundation for having me here today. Yes, as Annie Laurie said, earlier this year, I wrote an op-ed piece for the New York Times that appeared under the headline, Sick and Tired of God Bless America. It was their headline, not mine, but I liked it in a way I don't often like the headlines newspaper editors put over my articles. In this piece, I was discussing the political implications of a poll by the Pew Research Center, and I'm sure that many of you in this room are familiar with this poll, which indicated that the number of Americans who do not belong to any religious group, and even more important, I think, who say that religion is not very significant in their lives, has risen from 21 million in 2008 to more than 36 million in this election year. This is a lot of people, and an extraordinary increase within a very short period of time as historical time is measured. But the shift toward a more secular American population has not been really reflected in our politics. No candidate thinks that he or she has anything to lose by offending us. Now, I'm not here to talk about them, but about what we can do to become more influential in the public square, as has been alluded to by a number of people, most notably Rafita in that wonderful speech this morning. Inveighing against the perfidy of the religious right won't do it. We have to become more aggressive and more effective at bringing the message to the American public that secular values are American values, and not letting either the religious right or the religious left get away with what they've gotten away with for the past 30 years, the claim that religious is implicit in the phrase American values, and that the only real dispute is over what kind of religion is allowed to define the values. In some ways, the presidential campaign, now mercifully drawing to a close, I hope it'll be a mercy when the votes are counted, does not illustrate my point as clearly as other campaigns have in the past, in the recent past, because the 2016 campaign has been so dominated by the crazed, outsized personality of Donald Trump and the stated antipathy of many voters toward both Trump and Hillary Clinton, kowtowing to religion hasn't been quite as much a part of the day-to-day proceedings as it usually is. Now, that being non-religious is no guarantee of virtue is well demonstrated by the fact that Trump is probably the least religious candidate to be nominated by a major party since Thomas Jefferson. That's undoubtedly an understatement. Here we go. All right. And it's why Le Grand Orange, as my hair colorist calls him, picked Mike Pence, who is as far to the Looney Tunes religious right as you can get in this country, as his running mate. That's another thing that hasn't really gotten much attention. In fact, Trump's three wives and contentious divorces, which indicate that he never found his religion a barrier to his own, well, let's just call them lifestyle choices. It shouldn't fool anyone about a Trump administration would mean for the separation of church and state and secular interests in general. Just think of Trump's list of potential nominees for the Supreme Court. It's straight out of the religious right playbook. And he's also learned to appropriate the language of religious liberty, which actually means, used by the right, the conduct of public institutions should be determined by the most conservative faiths in the nation. Above all, there is the choice of Pence as Trump's running mate. He was raised in a devout Roman Catholic family, converted to right-wing evangelical Protestantism in college, a conversion so controversial within his family that his mother refused to be interviewed for the Times by an article about it. Unfortunately, I didn't know about Pence at the time I turned in the manuscript for my book about conversions. He would have been perfect. His particular religious conversion, which is so often the case during the past 30 years, Well, it doesn't matter. I need to have one page out. His particular religious conversion is what led him in Indiana to take the strongest anti-abortion measures you possibly could, even stronger than in Texas, and also opposition to LGBT. Very strong again. Now, on the Democratic side, we have a different kind of religious picture. Hillary Clinton is a Methodist, but she doesn't talk very much about it, except to talk about the Methodist creed, do all the good you can, and I'm going to return to that in a bit. And Tim Kaine, her vice presidential choice, is a very devout Catholic who is, like many American Catholics today, strongly pro-choice and pro-gay rights. Clinton and Kaine also, unlike Trump and Pence, speak out against the science deniers, almost all of whom are located at the extreme end of the religious and economic conservative spectrum. So we have an authentically religious presidential candidate who takes largely secular positions on public affairs, and a man who doesn't need to even know how to pronounce the names of the books of the Bible, climbing into bed with the far, far religious right. As citizens, unfortunately, one choice those of us in this room don't have is basing our activism on the premise that within the foreseeable future, there are going to be a lot of avowedly atheist candidates for high office to articulate support for secular government on the basis of proud, in-your-face secular values. At this stage of the development of the secular movement, articulating those values and articulating this forcefully is our job. The question is how to do it, particularly in a way that reaches out to people under 30, to that growing proportion of Americans who say religion is not very important in their lives. The problem is that a lot of these young people are still brainwashed enough by the public culture of religion that they are afraid, too, to openly call themselves, as the previous speaker mentioned, call themselves either atheists or agnostics, which is a softer term. And instead, they insist that they're spiritual but not religious. Now, we may be sick and tired of God Bless America, but we're not going to have a president anytime soon who replaces it with something else. Now, my choice would be This Land Is Your Land, but I'd be just as happy with that great classic, When the Moon Hits Your Eye Like a Big Pizza Pie, That's Amore. Listen, we're not even going to have a baseball commissioner who stops the odious practice, prevalent in many ballparks since 9/11, of replacing Take Me Out to the Ball Game, which I thought was the national anthem when I was a little kid, by the way, with God Bless America during the seventh inning stretch. So, we, again, people like us in this room, we are in the ironic and uncomfortable position of always being asked to choose between religious candidates who believe in the separation of church and state, as many do, and religious candidates who want to trash the separation of church and state. And this has rendered us relatively impotent politically in relation to our numbers, because no matter how often Democratic candidates ignore the role that the secular vote plays in the Democratic coalition, they do take our votes for granted, and it's understandable that they do. What atheist or agnostic or humanist or whatever a secularist chooses to call himself or herself is going to vote for a right-wing Republican as long as there's a Supreme Court? Even though the Republicans have refused to let President Obama appoint any Supreme Court justice in his last year of office, he's already appointed Justices Elena Kagan and Sonia Sotomayor. And who could imagine that a President George Romney would have appointed justices as dedicated to the separation of church and state as Kagan and Sotomayor have proved to be? So sitting on our hands and saying a pox on your house in this election or any other simply isn't an option, any more than it's an option for African Americans to sit things out and let someone become president when his answer to the shootings of young black men is more stop and frisk in the nation's cities. The question we have to ask ourselves is what we can do to bridge the gap between the stigma attached to ungodliness and the reality that the ungodly are now a much larger minority group than many religious denominations. Now, I know, seeing a lot of people in this audience with whom I've already had spirited discussions on this subject, one of them in the bar last night, that many of you are going to disagree with some of my positions, and you can have at me in the Q&A all you want. First, I want to talk about two tactics that don't, in my opinion, work. I feel uncomfortable with the slogan, good without God. Now, once we get through Halloween and the election, whichever turns out to be spookier, the annual onslaught of Christmas will bring about a revival of the well-meant, surely, but badly thought out attempt to convince our religious neighbors that we are as good as, or no worse than, those who believe in a deity. To me, there's something unseemly and self-abasing about basically saying to the world, I am not what other people say I am. Philip Roth made a similar observation about Jews when he was attacked by many influential American Jewish organizations very early in his career, because he wrote stories with Jewish characters who were not exactly models of rectitude and self-restraint. You can't construct a public identity out of saying, I don't fit your stupid stereotypes. I was once asked by the conservative talk show host Michael Medved, who happens to be an Orthodox Jew, he asked me, what's to stop you, accent on you, from committing murder if you don't believe in God? Now, I've been asked that question many times since, but that was a first, and all I managed to say at the time was, well, committing murder hasn't actually occurred to me. Which was actually true, since one thing I never believed, the first thing that I disbelieved about Catholicism was the idea that thinking about something is as bad as doing the deed itself. That never made any sense to me. I should have asked Medved. It's wonderful to think about what you should have said, but weren't quick-witted enough to come up on the spot was, what's to stop you from committing murder if your God orders it? He's done that in the past. In fact, he did it at the founding of your religion. And of course, the answer is that Abraham would have gone ahead and murdered Isaac if God, that prankster, hadn't recanted at the last minute and said, I didn't really mean it. I just wanted to see if you'd do it. I was really just joking. The story of Abraham, my compliments to Dan Barker, is really reason enough for my reservations about good without God campaigns. My beliefs have never told me that I have to kill my child to please some unnamed power in the universe. Second, and this is where I know some of you will disagree with me. I think we ought to choose our symbolic battles very carefully. I don't mean to suggest that symbols aren't important, but when they do go after symbols, they should be symbols that clearly violate the Constitution. Getting 10 commandments out of courthouses is important because these monuments support and perpetuate the myth that our laws are based on the prohibitions in the Bible. In fact, many of the commandments are not crimes, but in religious terms, sins. We don't try people for adultery anymore. We don't try anyone for coveting his neighbor's wife or ox or ass. We don't try anyone for not honoring her father and her mother, unless she's committing elder abuse, in which case we try her for assault. So the Ten Commandments have no place in courthouses. One of the reasons I truly respect the Freedom From Religion Foundation is that its lawsuits concerning symbols, like the one at the school in Pennsylvania that Marie talked about this morning, the FFRF suits focus on the public use of symbols that directly contradict not only the letter, but the spirit of the Constitution. But engaging in symbolic battles that have little or nothing to do with the Constitution, I think creates tremendous backlash and is a waste of energy. We had a classic example in New York a few years ago when the American Atheist attempted to bar the placement at the 9/11 Memorial Museum of a cross created by two steel beams that sort of twisted and melted into each other. Naturally, there was a resemblance to a crucifix. Beams initially in buildings are at right angles, so you can get a crucifix out of almost any combination of beams. This cross was to be displayed, and is now displayed, among many different kinds of artifacts. It was part of the history of the immediate aftermath of the terrorist attacks, and its presence amid the rubble was meaningful to many of the rescue workers. And it wasn't as if this cross were being given pride of place. It was simply going to be one of thousands of exhibits of objects from those times. The lawsuit predictably got nowhere in federal court, and it shouldn't have. You and I may think that finding meaning in two beams that accidentally became welded together is ridiculous. But the fact is that this accidental cross did have meaning for many people who were trying to pull human ashes out of the ground. What the whole episode of the lawsuit did was reinforce the image of atheists as an intolerant minority. Now, there would have been a constitutional issue if this cross had been placed atop the museum as the symbol of the museum. The atheist plaintiffs made all sorts of statements about how the non-religious were offended by this one display being included among many others. All I can say is they have to be pretty thin-skinned. Now, if there had been a statue of Prometheus found at Ground Zero, and it had been deliberately left out of the museum because it was considered too secular, that would be a symbolic case I'd support. One reason I also think it's important to pick symbolic battles carefully is that if we're all over the map, it dilutes the power of our voice when secular values have every, and secular people have every reason not only to be ethically offended, but can say rightly that it violates our Constitution. I wrote another New York Times op-ed earlier, after the Newtown school shootings, when President Obama went to an interfaith memorial and talked about Jesus watching over the grieving. And the fact is that a number of the victims there were Jews and Hindus, and we don't know, but we can assume if the Newtown population holds diverse views as reflected in the national polling data, that others were raised in secular homes. This would have been a perfect place for the President of the United States to acknowledge that violence violates decent secular and religious values, and that grief, mourning, and consolation are not limited to people who believe in a supernatural being who guides the world. But the president didn't do that. He talked only about religious consolation. When this happens, secular officials need to call, secular organizations and secular people need to call out public officials on it. Nobody did. Nobody in public office did. Now, that said, I think there are several things we can do and must do, and some of them are already underway and have been alluded to at this convention, to gain the political clout we don't have right now. First, we really need to concentrate on the young. I can tell you from my talks on campuses throughout the country that the secular movement has some of the same problems with people under 30 that traditional political parties have. The young are, in fact, much less religious than previous generations. They're largely responsible for the growth in the number of Americans who say religion is not important in their daily lives. But I can't tell you how many college students have told me that they don't want to be, quote, labeled. They always use that word, labeled as atheist. One student at the University of Minnesota told me it stands for a kind of nerdiness. The people who take part in campus free thought activities are seen as, well, a little obsessed. I've heard college-age women say exactly the same thing about their reluctance to be labeled feminists. Of course they want equal pay for equal work, the right to contraception, and to choose abortion if they need one. But they're also affected by the stereotype of the feminist as someone who doesn't like men and is too serious and nerdy to be attracted to the opposite sex. You're the first atheist feminist I've ever met, a student at Augustana College, which is a historically Lutheran institution in Rock Island, Illinois, said to me a few years ago, "Wow, it's great you wear lipstick and look like feminine. And it's obvious you don't hate religion," unquote. Actually, I told her there are a lot of religions I do hate, the ones that want to impose their values on me. "Okay," she said, "you don't hate all religion." And that's actually true. I think just showing up as our normal everyday selves, whenever we have an opportunity to interact with young people, it's immensely important. No, we don't have horns and tails. Yes, we do have jobs and kids and spouses and lovers and all of the concerns in our lives that the religious majority presumably has. Now, I don't participate in debates about the existence of God because I agree with Robert Ingersoll about the and every scientist, basically, about the impossibility of proving a negative. It's enough to say, based on all of the evidence before me, I see no reason to conclude that God exists. But, like all scientific theories, this conclusion has to remain theoretically open to new evidence. If I fly home tomorrow from this conference, and I find on my doorstep several beloved friends who have died in the last decade, waiting for me and asking if I can make them my spaghetti carbonara for dinner, then I'll have to consider that I might be wrong about the non-existence of a God. But in the absence of that, I can only uphold what the evidence I see before me shows me. There are, however, and I found this especially true at the historically religious colleges, all kinds of productive discussions you can have with young people who are really just beginning to think about and question the beliefs on which they were raised. By historically religious, I'm sure you know I don't mean the brainwashing factories like, say, Jerry Falwell's Liberty University. I particularly remember one conversation I had with a freshman at Augustana. He had come there planning to become a Lutheran minister, but by the end of his freshman year, he'd already decided he wanted to become a high school history teacher instead. He'd been raised in a very conservative Lutheran home with fundamentalist beliefs, but Augustana had exposed him to a much more liberal religious mindset. He said to me, "In my mind, you know you're right. I know you're right when you talk about the essential nature of beliefs and non-beliefs in a democracy, that they have to be treated equally. But," he said, I know that I'm in possession of the truth. And how can I not want the same thing for others?" I really felt sorry for this young man, because I sensed that this question was really a result of his own questioning of his faith. Because Augustana teaches more about comparative religion and the history of secularism, by the way, than most secular institutions do. That, in fact, is what I was doing there, being an adjunct to their history of secularism curriculum. I reminded this young man of the famous line in the gospel in which Pontius Pilate asks, "What is truth at Jesus' trial?" And I talked about how nothing in secular democracy denied him the right to proselytize in most places, but it would deny him the right to teach a history class in which he tells students that the Bible is literally true. Everywhere I speak, I find at least one young person, and sometimes many more, who wants to engage in a serious discussion about these subjects. And some of them have either never met an atheist or never met anyone they knew was an atheist before. The second vastly important area of secular action, which generally involves the defense of young people who are still too young to represent themselves, has to do with everything about education. The work FFRF is doing in battling the use of school assemblies to allow religious figures to promote their own after-school religious proselytizing in the guise of anti-bullying or anti-drug messages, this work of FFRF has been exemplary. In some states like Pence's Indiana, that means going to court. In others like Wisconsin, apparently just writing letters to school administrators scared them. The infiltration of these right-wing Christian-themed programs into schools is particularly troubling because the population being targeted is teenagers who are already at risk because of drug problems, academic issues, issues surrounding sexuality, sometimes all three. To open up kids like this to people who are essentially telling them that their problems can be solved by religious conversion is not only unconstitutional, but it's medically dangerous. But of course, people can die from this kind of attempted indoctrination, as we know from the stories of gay suicides. But of course, the biggest education problem, concentrated in the South and various parts of the Midwest, but also surfacing in school districts in every state in the Union, involves the teaching of evolution. And this can be a tough one because it means that secular parents have to come out and make trouble, which often does create trouble for their children. And all of this has to be accomplished at the local level because all a national organization can really do is provide some financial and legal support, which both FFRF and the Center for Inquiry, where I'm also an honorary board member, are doing. Fighting the troglodytes who at the very least want to sneak intelligent design into the curriculum as a theory on an equal par with scientific theory often requires banding together with liberal religious parents who also support the teaching of revolution. That's what happened in Dover, Pennsylvania, when parents did successfully fight against the law that mandated the teaching of intelligent design. And remember, when this battle ended in 2005 with a blistering federal district court ruling against the teaching of intelligent design as a scientific theory, it became a precedent, one which is being used in a lot of places today. The higher courts refused to review it. I don't think it's possible to overestimate the importance of fighting these battles and of cultivating, when we can, allies who aren't necessarily atheists, but who do believe in secular science and secular history. I mention history because we hear a lot more about evolution, but the right-wing attack on the teaching of the secular side of both American and world history is unremitting. Now, Texas is the most extreme example, with regular reviews of textbooks resulting in such gems as the replacement of Thomas Jefferson with Thomas Aquinas on a list of historical figures in revolutionary thought. This is one of the most amazing stories to come out of the last 5 years. I do think that secular parents must be willing to make pests of themselves to get any change in these matters. And being a pest can be effective even if you're not anywhere near being in the majority. Can you imagine what right-wing Christian parents would do if a teacher said something as mild as, "Some scholars don't think Jesus was a historical figure"? Well, that's what secular parents have to do when a teacher says that all of the founders of this country were devoutly religious. Frankly, there are places and times where this doesn't work, where we're so outnumbered that we can just be ignored. But there are a lot of other places like Dover where a lot can be accomplished just by having discussions with like-minded parents and friendly conversations with scared school administrators. One thing that has to be remembered is that school administrators don't want trouble for anyone, from anyone. So if we can't get anything avowedly secular into the curriculum, we can often get avowedly anti-secular interpretations out. Number three, I'd like to see more emphasis on certain major political issues on which all secular organizations agree. I realize this sounds like the beginning of a joke that begins, how many atheists does it take to screw in a light bulb? But I'll give you an example, an important example related to a talk we heard this morning. One of the most glaring omissions throughout this election cycle on the part of candidates from both parties has been any reference to the persecution of freethinkers in both Muslim theocracies and countries torn by Muslim and Hindu nationalist terrorism. The Center for Inquiry has been particularly good, like FFRF, on human rights issues. It has a full-time person, Michael Dodora, who does nothing else. But I can think of a lot more we can do. For example, I would like to have seen a full-page ad in a forum that politicians pay attention to. That'd probably have to be the New York Times, signed by every major secular and humanist organization, calling on all candidates not only to denounce the persecution of Christians, but the persecution of freethinkers who dare to blog about such issues as women's rights. From Saudi Arabia to the deserts controlled by terrorists to Bangladesh and now Indonesia, where some of the same things that have already happened in Bangladesh are beginning to happen. The letter should have been addressed to all of the four candidates. Since these persecutions are carried out not only against Christians but dissenting Muslims, an ad like this would be a good way to connect freedom of religion with freedom from religion. I don't know about you, but I would happily make a donation for a special fund to finance an ad like this. If Hillary Clinton is elected, I'd like to see a statement like this published on Inauguration Day, directly addressed to her, because this is something that not just the Congress, but only a president who is willing to take this on can help do something about. And we need, as secular organizations, to make constant approaches and reproaches to politicians who have a secular outlook on public affairs but are reluctant to stay so. This is tricky because it runs the risk, if secular voices are included at public events, of fueling the accusation that secularism is just another religion. Annie Laurie Gaylor is not the Pope. Neither is Richard Dawkins. What I really want to see at public events like Newtown is a politician who presents a secular perspective on a public trauma. And I don't think this is impossible. Look, no one would have thought, I think even 10 years ago, the acknowledgement of LGBT rights would be so taken for granted that the Democrats mention it so often that the phrase is in danger of losing its force. There is no reason with the growing secular population that this can't happen for us, especially since so much of that population is young. But it does require relentless political lobbying that we aren't yet fully engaged in, a constant set of reminders. I don't think, for instance, that John Kerry made a deliberate decision to leave secularists out of his litany of groups, including Christians and liberal Muslims, who are being persecuted in the Middle East. I think he just didn't think about it. I really do. I don't think it's possible to underestimate how little a lot of these people think about it. Finally, we do have to come out as who we are, and we have to do it with passion as well as reason, and make it personal. Now, talking about coming out to a group like this is obviously preaching to the converted, or rather the unconverted, but making it personal is even more important. And I do think a lot of atheists have trouble talking about what our values mean in our personal lives. One of the reasons I admire Robert Ingersoll so much is he constantly made the point that emotion and reason do not have to be seen as enemies, that the emotions we might describe as arising from the better angels of our nature flow from the development of the human brain through millennia of evolution and can be used for the rational improvement of humanity and society. Now, here's an example of the passion that's missing from the way some secularists present themselves today. In Ingersoll was writing an essay on Lev Tolstoy's novella Kreutzer Sonata, of all things. And as Ingersoll noted in his essay, it's in his collected works, it's online, music, like sexual passion, generates powerful emotions. And by the time Tolstoy wrote Kreutzer Sonata and had embraced a truly crazed brand of Christianity, He had become convinced that emotion is invariably at odds with duty and morality. Tolstoy and other religious ideologues had it exactly backward, Ingersoll argued. Quote, take emotions from the heart of man, he said, and the idea of obligation would be lost. Right and wrong would lose their meanings. We are liable and subject to conditions, liable to disease, pain, and death. Of these conditions, the possibilities and the emotions are born. And in a passage that displays the influence of both science and his own love of earthly pleasures, Ingersoll wrote, and I'm going to read this as a direct quote because it's a great quote, quote, we are conditioned beings, and if the conditions are changed, the result may be death or greater joy. We can only live within certain degrees of heat. If the weather were a few degrees hotter or a few degrees colder, we could not exist. We need food and roof and raiment. Life and happiness depend upon these conditions. We do not certainly know what is to happen, and consequently, our hopes and fears are constantly active. That is to say, we are also emotional beings. The generalization of Tolstoy, that emotion never goes hand in hand with duty, is almost the opposite of the truth. The idea of duty could not exist without emotion. Think of men and women without love, without desires, without passions. Think of a world without art or music, a world without beauty, without emotion, and without reason, unquote. One question I've been asked frequently is how it's possible to get through difficult times in life, including the knowledge of death, without believing in a loving supernatural being. It was Susan B. Anthony, who played down her own non-belief so she wouldn't alienate religious suffrages, who said, if it be true that we die like a flower, leaving behind only a fragrance, what a delusion the race has been in. What a dream is the life of man. She could not have been more wrong. What if we do die like a flower, leaving a faint and decidedly transient scent behind? It's a lot better than leaving a stench behind. Whether our actions are remembered on a large stage, for how long and by whom, is not the foundation of or the rationale for living what might be called the good life. The moral rightness or wrongness of our actions can no more be evaluated by how they will be judged in the future by human beings than by how they will be judged by a God in a supernatural afterlife. It's our acceptance that life is all there is, this life, not our expectations of immortality and perfect understanding in eternity that give our lives their moral meaning. Now, those of you who've heard me speak before know that I, like many pre-treat writers, rarely talk about my personal life. I keep that for my books. However, I'm going to make an exception at this point because it's so pertinent to the question of how important it is to get personal when we try to convey our values to others without claiming that we could be really good without God. 8 years ago, my longtime partner died of cancer. He had Alzheimer's disease, but fortunately, the cancer killed him before he entered the final stages in which all cognition and consciousness are destroyed. More than one friend said to me, I don't know how you can get through this without believing in God. Well, I don't know how I would have gotten through it if I did believe in a God who would slowly and methodically destroy a brilliant mind. During the last months of my partner's life, I often wrote him letters because he found it easier to absorb things when they were written down rather than spoken. This isn't true of everyone with Alzheimer's, but it was true of him. Here is an excerpt from a letter I wrote him after we had gone to a movie, as it turned out the last movie he would ever see. And this is what I wrote him, and this is a direct quote. Only a few weeks ago, when we saw that movie starting out in the evening, the one starring Frank Langella, I was deeply moved by a line in which he was describing his love for his former wife. She lived in my heart, he said, and I never found that again. Well, you're the only person who has ever really lived in my heart, and that will be true long after you're gone, until my last moment of consciousness on this earth. We don't believe in life after death, you and I, and we know we're not going to meet someday again in a place with puffy clouds and harps. Although if there were such a place, I would like Harpo Marx playing the harp. Yes, he laughed too, so he could understand. We have no children together, so the memory of the love we have won't go on in that way either. but I deeply believe that love is never wasted, and whatever good comes from it, we have passed on in some way to others, in everything from books to perhaps a greater tenderness than either of us might have shown without the other. Now we have only the moments of time we have, and we can only use them as best we can. I'm glad I saved a copy of this letter, because it brings back all the conversations we had during those months while the light of his mind was dimming but not yet extinguished. I know that the memory of what I was able to do to help him rests only with me. Well, now a small part of it with you. But it doesn't matter. It seems to me that the very essence of an atheist and humanist concept of morality is that love is never wasted, even though it's not eternal. Our acts, good and evil, become a part of the world that will continue after us, as long as the world continues. There's a grandeur in this view of life, as Darwin said at the end of his great work. But there is also a proportional humility in this view. The knowledge that this is our one and only life, a span between unconsciousness that precedes and follows our existence, lies at the heart of the atheist and humanist consciousness, conveying both the grandeur and the humility of this perspective is not only the duty, but the privilege of all of us who are not merely sick and tired of God bless of America, but who are convinced that rationality is the partner, not the enemy, of private love and public patriotism and loyalty. Thank you. Be happy to take questions. Thank you. Get some water.
Okay. So we'll take some questions. So, we will be able to take some. We'll be able to take some questions, and then we will come back. We will take a break after that. And I wanted to warn you that the books and sales items are going to be packed up after 5. This is going to be your last chance to purchase anything, including Susan Jacoby's books, and the last chance to get chances for your clean money. But we will take questions now. There are the microphones on either end, and then a little break, and back at 5.
Do you think we'll ever have an atheist president?
I'm sorry, the sound is...
Do you think we'll ever have an atheist president?
Do I think we'll ever have an atheist president? Well, if you'd asked me 20 years ago, would we ever have a black president, I would have said no. I don't think we're likely to have an avowedly atheist president in my lifetime. I'm 70. But I think it could happen. I wouldn't say no. I think it's less likely than a woman president.
Just sort of following on that, you didn't talk about Bernie Sanders. Clearly, I think people interpreted him as an atheist, cultural Jew, but obviously not practicing. And also, what about the third party candidates?
Now, first of all, this is a very interesting question about Bernie Sanders, who was interpreted as being a very secular candidate. What's interesting about it is, and I did mention this in the piece for the Times, is that even Bernie, when he was asked by Jimmy Kimmel directly on his show whether he believed in God, he evaded the question. He evaded the question, and he started talking about spirituality. And it was very noteworthy, and it shows how powerful the taboo against the word is. Because, I mean, I think Bernie Sanders probably is an atheist, but he wasn't willing to say it. And it was so unlike Bernie Sanders to take refuge in these unblunt words like spirituality. I mean, one of his great appeals was his bluntness. And so it shows that even for someone like that, it works. Did you ask me what I think of third-party candidates? Well, I didn't know anything. I won't say, this doesn't have a lot to do with what I do, but one thing we could do as a task in this election is A lot of young people are fooled by the label libertarian. I've found this in my appearances on campus in the next 6 months. They think libertarian just means something to do with liberty. They don't understand that the Libertarian Party, in addition to being absolute civil libertarians, as the ACLU would call it, are also right-wing in economics. And of course, at the time I did most of these speeches, I didn't know how stupid Gary Johnson was. It was before the Aleppo moment, and it was also before, after he couldn't name a foreign leader, he said that, well, because he didn't know anything about the rest of the world, that meant he wouldn't make war on anybody. That's never been a barrier to anyone before. So anyway, this has nothing to do with my being an atheist, but I do think that a vote for a third party is a wasted vote. And I'm doing everything I can to use all the influence I have with my 26-year-old niece to convince her of that, and I think I've succeeded. And I think we should all do likewise if we have decent relations with anybody young in our families. Yes, sir.
Well, as a libertarian, I apologize for stumbling into a Democratic caucus, but I have a question for you. As a libertarian with respect to foreign policy, and I don't want to be accused of being sexist because of the words I'm using, it's just a phrase here. It appears our fathers, sons, brothers, and husbands are in Afghanistan to protect the women against their fathers, sons, husbands, and brothers. Now, I don't think our foreign policy should be designed to have young girls learn algebra in Afghanistan or anywhere else. Our foreign policy should be for our national interest. So I ask you why an agent of the state, a president, should stick their nose into the domestic affairs of another country when it doesn't affect our national interest.
Why, you're a libertarian, why an agent of the state shouldn't stick his nose into the affairs of other countries? Well, I don't know.
When it doesn't affect our national interest.
That doesn't affect our national interest. Well, you made a good point. I guess whether young girls in Afghanistan are free to learn algebra may not directly affect our national interests. The truth is, probably Afghanistan can go to hell and we'll still be all right. But that raises an interesting question, which is true about human rights, which is the promotion of human rights in our national interest? Now, I am no foreign policy expert, so I'm not going to go on about this since this is not my purchase. But I would say that ignoring human rights probably has affected our national interest quite negatively in many times over the years. When you look back, for instance, over the Holocaust, when you look back over what we might have been able to do, not necessarily could have, but might have been able to do to shorten the amount of time to bomb the tracks at the end of the war. When you look at, and particularly pertinent today, what we didn't allow about emigration then, when we could have at that point, I think you have to, looking retrospectively, see many points at which our human rights record has affected our national interest.
Then you want us to be the policemen of the world.
No, I do. No,
I want to get off that slippery.
No, I don't want us to be involved in every war, but I think human rights and the slaughter of and often it's religiously motivated, the slaughter of millions of people, the starvations and bombing in Syria. I think let's say both human rights and humanitarianism, it dictates at least a look, and not necessarily by military intervention. Yes, sir.
I was wondering if this is the Freedom from Religion Foundation for USA alone or the rest of the world.
Well, that's actually pertinent to his question. He asked if you heard, is the freedom from, are we talking about freedom from religion for the USA or for the rest of the world? I think as far as the rest of the world is concerned, we're only interested in religion if it's used as a repressive weapon. In other words, there isn't there isn't, for example, freedom of religion in Saudi Arabia, let's say. But I think you do have to look carefully. Saudi Arabia is our ally. The fact is, we are involved with an ally which not only imprisons and tortures Christians, but imprisons and tortures free thinkers and so forth. And so that we have to think about that. I think it's true that a lot of the rest of the world does not hold freedom of religion as a value or freedom of speech. And there's no question that I feel like I'm getting in a position of sounding like one of those morning pundits, which I don't want to. But I don't think that we can impose our concept of freedom of religion on the rest of the world. But that's a different thing from standing by while all kinds of people are massacred at some point in countries that do touch on our national interest and security. Russia, for instance, I lived in Russia when I was a young journalist for 2 years during the Soviet era, in which the practice of religion was largely forbidden, except for mild Russian Orthodoxy. But what has happened? It happens so often under dictatorships. What is one of the things that Putin has done during the last 3 years? He has formed an alliance with the Russian Orthodox Church. It never went away during all of those years of communism. It was just waiting there. And the reason Putin has done this is that the Russian Orthodox Church calls on Russian nationalism, which is what Putin is all about. It is no surprise that the women of Pussy Riot were arrested when they made a demonstration at a church. And what they were demonstrating against was the reunion of church and state that they saw occurring under Putin. Now, this is something that, not that there's anything we can do about it, Russia is what it always was. It is the other big dog with nuclear weapons. But the fact is the union between the Orthodox Church and Putin's government is something that potentially affects our national interests a lot. Burying your head in the sand and saying it doesn't, well, it doesn't work for me.
If you don't mind a follow-up, why would we limit ourselves to not imposing freedom from religion on the rest of the world when the rest of the world wants to impose various forms of religion on the rest of us?
Well, for one thing, here's where I would certainly agree with the libertarians. The idea of imposing freedom from religion on the rest of the world is sort of against what we stand for, really. I mean, if you're talking about imposing what most people in this room believe about religion on the rest of the world, you can't. The only thing we can work for in the rest of the world are to promote and support societies to the extent we can, probably mostly through economic aid and getting the people who are really out of luck out, the dissidents, is to promote the idea that people should be free to believe what they want to. But the idea of imposing freedom from religion on the rest of the world, imposing anything about religion on the rest of the world, and the fact, by they, I assume you mean radical Islamists, well, they're not going to impose their religion on us, period. Anybody who thinks they are is living in a delusion. And that has nothing to do with any questions about immigration to the United States, which are a whole other area, which I'm not going to get into because I don't have time. We have time for one or two more questions, and there's a young man behind you. Yeah. Well, but as an American, forget about being an atheist, I don't think our actions should be dictated by what some bad thing somebody elsewhere in the world might want to do. Defend ourselves from them. That's what we should do. And we don't do that by imposing any kind of a monolithic vision of ours on the rest of the world.
This is a pretty simple question, so it probably won't take too long. I just wanted to know your opinion as a political observer, analyst, about the revelation yesterday from the Washington Post published about the audio clip with Trump.
You had to ask.
I have to ask, basically two questions. How will it affect the debate tomorrow night, in your opinion? And how will it affect, if at all, the outcome of the election?
Well, actually, I have an answer to that. Which actually relates to the purpose of my talk. It isn't entirely about arguments about the election and libertarianism and Republicans and Democrats. I found myself fascinated by the reaction to this. The only people who've withdrawn their endorsement from Trump are the Mormons, and you have to hand it to them, at least they are consistent. Several prominent Mormon politicians have withdrawn their initial endorsement of Mr. Donald J. Trump. But it's interesting. This conversation 10 years ago, which has more impact on the world simply because it was recorded. It's not somebody saying, this guy said something to me. But there's nothing in it that really is a surprise in terms of his previous behavior. And it's interesting that there is so much more of a reaction to this than there has been to the equally bad things he said about immigrants, about women, about all kinds of things. And I think this does have to do with the leftover Puritanism and religiosity of America. I think that this was too much for parts of the religious right. We'll see if it's too much for the non-Mormons. But that this particular thing is hitting the religious right harder is because it has to do with sex and marriage and all these ideas about sexual sins being the worst possible sins that people can commit. I think it's a residue of our Puritanism and not even modern evangelicalism. You know, it's all right. The reason the evangelical right, you know, you could get married three times and have three wives as long as you get divorced and remarried. This is also a tough nut for the religious right to swallow, because this little talk came only a few months after he'd married his new wife, Melania, after leaving his second wife, Marla, and his new wife was already pregnant with their child. So I think that the reaction to this is stronger. How much stronger it is remains to be seen, and how much it lasts. But I think it's stronger because it had to do with sex, even though there's certainly nothing worse about it than there is about anything else he said. Also, the reaction of women to this is stronger. I heard some women on MSNBC and Fox News before I came down. And the reaction of women to this is stronger, again because it's saying something. And hearing that somebody may have said something and actually hearing them say it, and it doesn't show much. The women I heard who were defending him on Fox News said, well, this is the way guys talk to each other on the golf course. Well, I don't know who the women of Fox News are married to, but I really think that it is not the way all men talk to each other on the golf course. And the one reason I actually don't believe that Bill Clinton said worse things to him on the golf course, because I think Bill Clinton, although he has shown that he can really be stupid too, but I don't think he would have said that to Donald Trump in any place where there might have been a hot mic. I mean, remember, this guy was talking to a guy from Access Hollywood. I mean, I would be really careful. Is anybody here from Access Hollywood in this room? I hope not. Thank you.